Great. Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks for coming along. This is a session about Office 365 identity management. My name is Paul Andrew, and I work in the Office 365 team in Washington State in the US. And I work on identity management, and I also work on some of the commerce systems that we have. My role is a technical product manager. I've worked in the US for Microsoft for about 8 years, and prior to that, I worked for Microsoft in New Zealand. It's great to be back down this end of the world, so looking forward to a fun-packed session. This session is an overview of identity management, and the goal of the session really is to talk to you about the different options that you have with Office 365 related to identity, rather than to get into detail about how you would implement them. So what I hope that you'll get out of this is when you look at a customer, you'll have an idea of the different ways that they can use their identity systems or their directory systems with Office 365, and where you'll need to go or what kind of terms you'll need to use to be able to tell people how they should go about setting that up. At some later point, you'll want to learn about how to actually do it, but that's not the topic of this afternoon. Also, I want to cover a couple of recent features that we've added for identity management for Office 365, we'll show some demos of those with the network willing. All right, so first off, I've got an overview of identity management in Office 365. Second, the recently announced features to talk through and demo, and then I'll walk through the six different ways that you can integrate identity with Office 365 right now. All right, so is everyone in the right place? We're ready? Let's go. So first off, very basic, identity management, what is it? Identity, when you're talking to a business person, may not be a simple concept. To a lot of us who work in IT, it really is. Identity is something you understand. But there's some terms that you want to know how to be able to describe to people. And one of those is identity itself. Identity is typically just talking about a directory. We used to have, in the old days, we just have phone lists, and phone lists eventually got email addresses tagged onto them, and then someone realized that this was too complex to manage on a piece of paper, and we needed to have some kind of system to manage it. And so an identity management system is really just about managing who your users are and various properties that you have about those. So a couple of key concepts about identity management is we need to authenticate who a person or maybe a device is from that directory that we have. We have to figure out, are you the person that you say you are, and how do we manage that? And the second thing is, once we know who you are, we want to be able to authorize you onto certain systems. So two key concepts, authentication and authorization, relates to identity management. Concepts which typically are not required in the real world. When you're looking at someone, maybe they have a badge with a photo, but typically you don't have to go through any kind of cryptographic means to verify that someone who you meet in the street is who they say they are. So concepts that are not necessarily familiar to non-IT people, and good to be able to explain rather than just saying auth N and auth Z, as a lot of people do. So a couple more terms just before we get going. Single sign-on talks about being able to sign on to one system and then automatically being signed on to another. And so the classic example of single sign-on is if you have a very homogeneous Windows NT domain and your users sign on to their local PCs, then they're signing on to the Active Directory, and by being signed on to that local PC, their credentials will carry on to any other Active Directory connected systems that you have throughout your organization. So you sign on once and your credentials flow through all of these other systems. Single sign-on is much harder to do when you're outside of your corporate intranet than it is when you're inside. When you're inside your corporate intranet, you have one directory. Hopefully, if you're lucky, you have one at least, and that one directory, if managed right, is very easy to get single sign-on with. So single sign-on is kind of tricky. By the way, Yelp is what you get if you don't have single sign-on. You have yet another username and password for every system that you go to, and people have to type all these things in, and they write them down on bits of paper, and they use the same one everywhere, and we have all these bad things going on. Single sign-on, it turns out, is typically fairly complex technology, and we introduced the concept of a relying party. Now, a relying party, when you're talking about single sign-on, is usually just an app. some kind of application running somewhere that needs to know about the identity. And this app relies on a directory provider. So it's known as the relying party. And so you have your identity provider and you have a relying party, and between the two of them you can establish various cryptographic systems that give you what's known as single sign-on. So that's the holy grail, is to get single sign-on across all your web-connected systems and all your local systems that you have. A couple more terms down the bottom, security assertion markup language. It's kind of used in a lot of places when we bring identity systems onto the web. SAML is both the format of a token to take a cryptographic key that proves who you are between an identity provider and a relying party. It's used to name that token. It's also used to name some of the protocols that carry that token. And it's a tricky differentiator because in some cases your identity provider and your relying party will talk the SAML protocol, and in other cases they just have SAML tokens that are going between them, maybe using a protocol such as WS Federation. So WS Federation and WS Trust, this is what Office 365 uses primarily with Active Directory Federation services. So it tends to be considered as the native Microsoft protocols. And WS Fed is different to the SAML protocol, but it in fact uses SAML tokens that go between the identity provider, which in ADFS is, in an Active Directory environment terms, is the ADFS server, and the relying party, which you would think of as Office 365. So that's enough terms. If you could explain those terms to your business people and maybe draw some of those on a whiteboard, unlike how I handed it straight out to you verbally, then you get in a good place to be able to have some of the next level of conversations about what you need to do in order to make what seems a very simple topic of take my directory, make it work in the cloud, and have people understand why it's a little more complicated. All right, we have one more term, being Microsoft, to define, this is the difference between the Microsoft account, also known as the Live ID, also known as various other terms over the years, which is what we have at Microsoft for signing on to consumer services. And so you might have at Outlook.com or an at Hotmail.com, or in fact you can have any email address associated with a Microsoft account. However, a Microsoft account is very different to what we use for commercial customers. For business customers, we use this thing called Windows Azure Active Directory, which has an organizational account. And it's important to understand the difference between these. We see a lot of customers who will assume that you can use one where you can use the other, and it gets into all sorts of difficult conversations about why you can't. So if you're working with a system that requires an organizational account, in most cases you can't use a Microsoft account. The organizational account is defined as an identity that's owned by the organization that has signed up for a tenant with Microsoft. So if a company signs up for an Office 365 tenant, that company owns the directory. It's not owned by Microsoft. It's owned by the company that has paid for that. The email addresses associated with that are essentially the data, the personally identifiable information for that company. And so there's an important differentiation of that ownership there for privacy reasons, for liability reasons, and the Microsoft account, on the other side, is largely owned by Microsoft, although it's the responsibility of the individual consumer. So there's a difference there where the organization is responsible for all of their employees. They're also responsible for all of the users that they create in their account. An organization is responsible for support that they provide for identities in their organizational account. So where there's help desk, users who are inside of a Windows Azure Active Directory, who have one of these organizational IDs, they're going to call their organization's help desk and get some support from that. They're not going to call Microsoft because Microsoft is providing the service but not responsible for the directory. For a Microsoft account, consumers do call Microsoft, and Microsoft is the first point of call to seek help and get assistance with a Microsoft account. You also don't get a company directory, a GAL, to look up people with a Microsoft account. You have to add users individually to your friends lists and do all this kind of stuff. With an organizational account, these kind of things are all just built in. So there's a number of differences there between these two systems. They're kept separate. They're in isolated areas in data centers. So we keep data separate from consumer data, from organizational data. However, you still have to be careful that people don't type in an organizational account where they need a Microsoft account. Some typical areas where that happens is when people want to sign on to their Windows 8 PC. Windows 8 PC requires a Microsoft account to sign in order to be able to download apps. But if you're logging on to a domain from Windows 8 PC, then you're going to be wanting to use your organizational account. And I've certainly seen users get confused about those two. So let's move on. So we're going to be talking today about Windows Azure Active Directory. And this has been around for quite a while. It's always been the directory that we've had at Microsoft for Office 365, although it's only got a name fairly recently. And that's because it's only very recently been available to access and manipulate the directory without going through Office 365. For the past several years, it's just been something that you access as part of Office 365. So you create users, you can edit their properties, you do all of that in Office 365. Recently, it's been available to other applications, and it's available to connect to and manipulate. It has various APIs that you can access it. It has its own UX through Windows Azure that you can go in and modify the directory. It has various Microsoft applications that are using it, that have started using it in addition to Office 365. And it's very much like having Active Directory, but having your own OU for your organization in the cloud. And very much we consider an organization's directory in Windows Azure Active Directory as an OU, and it's implemented largely like an OU and separated from other customers in that way. So we're going to be talking largely about how Office 365 uses Windows Azure Active Directory and how you can synchronize identities into that directory, or how you can edit users there. And there's three main ways that we talk about being able to do this. And this is really the crux of figuring where your customer is and what you should be recommending to them, is understanding these three ways that you can get identities, users, properties, etc., into Windows Azure Active Directory, and therefore into Office 365. So we've got cloud identity, directory synchronization, and federated identity. The first one is cloud identity, and all this means is you've created an Office 365 tenant, you go to users and groups, and you say new user, and you enter their properties. A cloud identity is created in the cloud, usually through the Office 365 users and groups administration UI. And all of your editing and working with that user identity for a cloud identity is done through Office 365. It's always in the cloud. This identity is never synchronized to any kind of on-premise system. It's just up there. And you can access it either through the APIs, just through Office 365 itself, a third-party application, whatever you want. But it's not synchronized to any other system. This means that it's the simplest way to get going. You can very quickly create a test tenant for Office 365 and add users to it. You just go in and do it. You don't have to do any setup to configure it, to connect to anything else. Primary downside of it is you have to use the Office 365 cloud administration UI to edit your users. You know there's an exception to that. You could use PowerShell, but basically your UX is restricted to what you can do through Office 365. And this is typically not powerful enough if you have large numbers of users. Office 365 will only show you 20 users at a time, so if you want to manipulate many thousands of users, 20 users at a time is probably going to take you a little while. It's analogous to the problem of managing your phone list on a piece of paper and finding there's too many people to keep on the bit of paper and having to do it on a computer system. Well, if you're doing it on a computer system, which is fairly simplistic, like the users and groups in Office 365, you're going to run into times where you just want to do more. You want to manipulate large numbers of users. So the downside of cloud identity is it's typically not suitable for large organizations that require specific identity management solutions. So the second one we have here is directory synchronization. And this is where you have an existing Active Directory and you just want to synchronize everything that's in that Active Directory into the cloud. And so the directory sync tool is downloadable from the Office 365 tenant. If you go into users and groups, there's a button there you can click on to download it. And you can install that on a single member server inside your organization, and it will synchronize all your users from Active Directory up into the cloud. So this is pretty good for many organizations. It's going to get you to where you want, which is a cloud system, with still being able to edit those identities on-premises. I'm about to start talking about password hash sync, which is a new feature we added to this in June, where you can tell the directory synchronization tool that you want users in the cloud to be able to use the same password as they do on-premises. If you don't enable password hash sync and you're using directory synchronization only, then your users have to create separate passwords in the cloud and on-premises, and they can make them the same or they can enter different ones. It's just a little bit complicated. Password synchronization or having the same password on-premise in the cloud is one of the most predominant reasons why people move to the third option, which is federated identity. So directory synchronization is gets your directory into the cloud. What federated identity does is provides you with all authentication requests being done on-premise. So if your users come up to Office 365 and they enter their username and password, Office 365 is going to say, hey, wait a minute, I need your on-premise directory to authenticate that user. So we're going to show a web page from the on-premise server. We're going to ask the user to authenticate themselves there. And then that authentication is going to be used by Office 365. So by federated, all we're saying is Office 365, Windows Azure Active Directory are federated with the on-premise identity provider. So Microsoft's implementation of identity federation is ADFS, Active Directory Federation Services. And a typical implementation of ADFS would add about half a dozen servers to an environment and might take 6 weeks to deploy. Really, the difference between just doing directory synchronization and federation is federation is typically going to require Office 365 to reach out to the federation servers, and the federation servers, therefore, have got to be accessible on the internet for Office 365 to be able to do that. So that's one technical issue, which takes time to implement. Another is they've got to be always available. So they've got to be typically redundant and have multiple connections to the internet, multiple servers, so if one goes down, there's others there. If you don't do that and you're using ADFS or another federated identity system, if your identity provider is offline for any reason, that means your users can't log in because all login requests go to the federated identity server. Federation requires directory synchronization is the last part of this slide here. So in order for federation is just the login. So in order for your users to appear in a directory on Office 365, you've also got to use DirSync to get the identities up there. So we've got three possibilities. Cloud identity, where you're just adding users in the cloud. And they're not on-premise at all. Great for new companies or new organizations that have no on-premise directory and not really big ones. Directory synchronization, we're going to take all of your directory or a specific OU from your on-premise directory, and we're going to move all that up into the cloud. And we're going to do it with a single server. It's pretty quick to deploy. And then federated identity goes one step further and can give you single sign-on. So we'll talk a lot more about these, but essentially, if you understand these three options, there's a lot of details underneath that you want to learn about, but if you understand these three options, you'll be able to make a good choice for most organizations to get going. Many organizations will start with directory synchronization only and then have some reason why they want to move to a federated identity solution. And so that's because federated identities require DirSync, it's a good way to start. You get directory sync tool going and then you can plan your federation solution later. It's not very common to find people starting with a cloud identity and moving to directory synchronization or to federated identity. There's a bit more work to do there. All right, so that's the overview. The second part of this talk is about some recent additions that we have. And the first one I wanted to talk about is this password hash synchronization. So the directory sync tool is something I said is downloadable from Office 365. If you're an administrator on a tenant, and if you're not, you should get a trial and be an administrator. Take a look at it. In the users and groups settings page, you can download the directory synchronization tool. And it runs this wizard. There's six pages to this wizard. Welcome, Windows Azure Active Directory credentials, Active Directory credentials, hybrid deployment, et cetera, et cetera. And once you step through those on your member server, directory sync is installed and it's off to the races. DirSync requires SQL Server and it installs SQL Server Express on the machine by default. If you have a large directory, you'll want to have a dedicated SQL Server, but it uses SQL Server to keep track of what it's synchronizing. And the addition that we've made in June is to add this page and this checkbox here to enable password sync. So password sync simply takes the password, the hash of the password, which is stored in the on-premise Active Directory, performs another hash operation on that password hash, and then sends that up to Office 365. So it's included in the Windows Azure Active Directory. And by doing this, that means that a user in the cloud can go ahead and log in with their regular password that they use on-premise. And if they change their password on-premise, we'll synchronize up the change in 2 minutes. So we'll synchronize up the change, and then they can log in with their new password. They cannot change their password in the cloud, which would be convenient. We don't synchronize passwords back down or do anything like that. The password never actually leaves the on-premise Active Directory server. It's just a hash of that we use for verification purposes. All right, so comparing password hash sync with single sign-on using ADFS, I have this little table here. So the first thing, the first line is typically the thing that we hear as the predominant reason people want to go with ADFS is they want their users to have the same password on-premise and in the cloud. It's a very reasonable request. So a lot of people I've been talking to will say, hey, password sync and password hash sync and dir sync is going to do that for me, so I'll get going with that, and then we'll see what else they need. I'd also hear from a lot of people who have some reason, there are a lot of different things that you can't do just with dir sync, that you might need a more advanced solution. So another thing that you can do with password sync is password policies being controlled on-premise. Password policies using Group Policy Editor are the same whether you're using password sync or ADFS. Password sync doesn't actually enforce the password policies, but because it gets the passwords from on-premise, those policies have already been enforced. So the policy-enforced passwords, if you like, are what we shift up into the cloud. We can also support two-factor authentication with password sync. Multi-factor authentication is something that we're in the process of adding to Windows Azure Active Directory, and I'm going to talk about that in a moment. So some things that you can't do with password sync. No password re-entry if on-premises. So single sign-on on-premises, where if you log on to your Windows PC at the start of the day and you get single sign-on to all your different systems, this can also work with Office 365, but not if you're using password sync. So if you're using ADFS, and I know we have this configured at Microsoft, if I'm signed on to my PC and I go to Office 365 and I'm actually connected to the corporate network, bam, I'm logged on. I don't have to enter my password again for Office 365. Very convenient. Actually very inconvenient if you're trying to do demos, because you keep going up to Office 365 to log on with a test tenant and you're logged in. And so, but for regular users, I imagine it would be great. Client access filtering by IP or time schedule. You can do these things with Active Directory, and ADFS will enforce those for you. Password sync does not. It's just going to check if the password's right, and if the password's right, we're going to log you on. Authentication occurs on premises. Can immediately block disabled users. So there's a couple of reasons why some organizations will require all authentications to happen on premises. One is so that you can turn off a user like that, and you know they're not going to be able to get on ever again. But a more common one is for auditing. More companies will want to audit all their authentication requests and have them appear in a single log. And to do that means you have to have all those authentication requests happen in a single place. And you don't get that with password sync. Change password from the web, we talked about this already. With password sync, you actually have to have your users VPN in or go to the company location and log in to be able to change their password. With ADFS, you can have users change their password on the web. You can pop up a web form and let them change their password that way. So this may be a problem if your users are always on the road or never have access to the place where the servers are, maybe for a retail shop or something else like that. Works with Forefront Identity Manager. Password Sync does not. So if you're using Forefront Identity Manager for any other reason, which I haven't listed, then Password Sync is not for you. All right, let's go back. So I want to show Password Sync demo. So this is a real quick demo. I don't know how many of you are sitting there thinking, what can he possibly show to demo Password Sync? Well, I thought about that. And what I want to show is, here's my Office 365. So I'm going to log on here with this user, pandrew. And I'm going to put my password in here. And I'll type it real slow so you can follow along. Everyone got my password? Good. Okay, so we'll sign in. I hope I got my password right after that. All right, we're signed in. So I got my lovely Wave 14, actually, Office 365 tenant. And you can see that I have signed in. All right, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to go on-premises. So here's a machine that is inside of my corporate network. Okay, and here's me changing the clock. I put the clock here because, if you remember, I said it takes 2 minutes for a password change request to happen. So what I want to show you is this is a machine that has the DirSync tool on it, and it's enabled for password sync. So I thought, hey, why don't we go and change the password, and then we'll see if we can log on with a new password online. So that's a demo of password sync. It takes 2 minutes, so let's take a look, see if you learn something. All right, so first off, I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to refresh. If you're familiar with Event View, you know it puts this little bang here when there's new events, so I know to hit F5. So what I'm going to do is go to Windows Security and change a password, and I'll put in my original password. And just so that you can tell that I'm putting in a different password, we'll make it one character. Password's been changed. All right, so now what I have to do is it's 10:54 p.m. I've got to wait for 2 minutes. Does anyone know a good joke? Two smartphones went into a bar. I forget the request, the rest. You have a question?
Yeah, I have a question.
Do you mind if I answer it like a joke? So the question is, I think, basically related to password policy. If I change my password,
and it tries to sync with the 365,
yeah.
The password's already been used, does it error, or does it allow it to go through?
So it's just going to go straight through, because when you're using password sync policy, we're not using any of the password change code that's on Office 365. We're essentially just taking the hash of the password out of Active Directory, up it goes, whatever it is. So that was 1 minute. Great.
Is it going over port 80 or is it using LDAP?
Well, variously it's doing both. It does the DirSync tool, we actually publish the ports that it uses, and I'm pretty sure it uses 443 for synchronizing, and it also requires access to the certificate root servers. Otherwise it won't work. So there's another port that needs to be open for that.
So it can go through existing internet forward proxies?
Yes, yes. Assuming you're allowing internal servers to get to certificate servers. And you can lock its IP addresses down as well. But it does use LDAP to talk to the Active Directory server on-premise. So it needs to be on the same Oh, it looks like we've got our bang. So my bang's appeared here telling me there's new messages. So you can see here is a, I've got a bit of logging turned on here. Event ID 657 says my password has been synchronized. So let's go and take a look. And there's my one character password. It didn't work. I did that on purpose. Okay. All right, so we can log on. That's how you demo password hash sync. All right, while we're here, are there any other questions that people have burning about password hash sync? One here.
How are the passwords hashed and stored in the cloud? The same as AD, or is it different hashing algorithm?
So it's a great question. And we take the hash directly out of Active Directory, and then we apply another hash, which we have not published. So they are hashed in two different ways. The first is the standard hash out of AD, and the second, before we transfer it to Windows Azure Active Directory, is not published. Any other questions? DirSync itself does sync some properties back. It doesn't sync the passwords back. It has a small number of properties that we sync back for. We call them write-back properties for various reasons. We have a bunch of detail about that online in TechNet for DirSync. Just take a look. They're largely a little obscure. At the back? I'm sorry, what about the... Oh, what about the wrong password? So actually, this is a different feature that we added, unrelated to password sync, because it also applies to ADFS passwords. If you get a password incorrect 10 times on Windows Azure Active Directory, then we're going to start challenging you with pictures of badly spelled words. So theoretically, your Active Directory is not going to lock out your accounts in less than 10 mistakes, right? So we're going to block people doing mass password attacks online long before they hit your Active Directory too much. All right, shall we move on there? Looks like I'm going too slow. So the next thing that I wanted to talk about, is multi-factor authentication. So this is something that is currently in preview for Windows Azure Active Directory and also for Office 365. Multi-factor authentication means we use multiple factors, and people typically explain this as something you know, i.e. a password, along with something you have, i.e. a cell phone or a smart card or a one-time code device. So something you know plus something you have means multiple factors of authentication. It is aimed at avoiding people being able to guess your password from another part of the world and then being able to log in as you, particularly if you're an administrator or someone with access to high-value information, you might want to have a second factor of authentication. So someone literally has to steal your cell phone or your device and also get your password to be able to log in as you. It's becoming required in some regulatory environments, some countries' governments, particularly the United States, are requiring multi-factor authentication of particular types. Certainly as more and more companies are moving to the cloud and realizing that, to guess my password, users don't need to be inside my building. They can be on the other side of the world, which is typically not the case for organizations that are on-premises based. Typically, you will have to be inside the building in order to guess someone's password. So it does, multi-factor authentication is a big help with that. So there's three types of multi-factor authentication that we will be supporting as part of this this new feature. It's called Windows Azure Multi-Factor Authentication. It is functionality that Microsoft purchased from a company called Phone Factor. Microsoft purchased Phone Factor in October 2012, and we've been integrating this in with Windows Azure Active Directory, and it's available, or it's going to be available when it's out of preview for Office 365 customers. It can accept as a second factor of authentication mobile app on Windows Phone, iOS, or Android. It can also accept a phone call as in, we're just going to call you up, and if you answer the phone and press the hash key, then we'll assume that you want to log in. And you can also take a text message. We have a few variants of these things, such as the text message can provide you a number that you have to type in, or the mobile app can show you a number that you have to type in, or not if you don't want to. So there's a few different things there. This is a little bit about the architecture of Windows Azure multi-factor authentication. You're going to start by signing in from a device with your username and password. And once you've done that, Windows Azure Active Directory knows that your account has multi-factor authentication configured, enabled, and required for it. And then we're going to prompt for the second factor of authentication. So we're going to show you a little dotted line running across, and your phone's going to ring. And after that's happened, we'll enable you to log into the application, such as Office 365. Now, one thing about multi-factor authentication is it requires a modification to the client that is doing the login. And we have enabled all of the web browser-based features that are part of Office 365, so Outlook Web Access, SharePoint Online, Link Online, all these kind of things support multi-factor authentication directly. They do this using something called passive authentication because they are web browser-based. For rich clients, such as the Office rich clients, something like Outlook, Outlook does not have multi-factor authentication built in. So when you log in through Outlook, Outlook just needs to have a username password, and it can't sort of stop and wait while something else goes on. And so for rich client applications, when a user is enabled for multi-factor authentication, we use this thing called app passwords. And what an app password is it is a 16-character, randomly generated password, which is shown to the user one time, and the user is expected to copy that and paste it into an application. And a user can create up to 40 of these app passwords for different applications. They can delete them when they've forgotten what they're for or they've stopped using them. By using an app password, a user who's enabled for multi-factor authentication can put in their username in Outlook and put in an app password and have more security than if they just used their account password. Not as significant security as if they had a second factor of authentication, but something that a security administrator would have to decide if that's enough for their rich client applications. Because an app password is only used by the apps, it isn't possible to break into it from a web browser. If you're connecting to Office 365 and you're authenticating against Windows Azure Active Directory using a web browser to an account that has multi-factor authentication required, you can't use an app password. So app passwords are there for rich client applications. And I think we should take a look at this as well. So switch over. All right, so let's first take a look at the administrator view. So if I come in here and sign on as an administrator to Office 365, all right, here's my admin center. I'm logged on as a global administrator. So I'm going to go into users and groups, and I want to enable a user for using multi-factor authentication. All right, so here I'm in users and groups, and we have this new tag here. By the way, Active Directory synchronization, this is where you go and get the DIR sync tool and set that up. We have this new tag here, set multi-factor authentication requirements. So let's click on that. And here we are in the multi-factor authentication. You can see this is in preview. I'm going to go and set sign in allowed users. And I'm going to choose a user here to enable for multi-factor authentication. And we're going to choose Bonnie Kearney. Bonnie K. So let's go and enable Bonnie K. Now, I'm getting a warning here because app passwords are going to be required if Bonnie uses non-browser applications. So we'll say that's okay. Okay, and it's gone and done that. So now when Bonnie logs in, and let's log Bonnie in. She's been enabled for multi-factor authentication. Now, we actually do this enabling in, we have three steps. A user is disabled, so they don't have any multi-factor authentication. And then they're enabled. And when they're enabled, we actually allow that user to log in from rich clients without their password, without multi-factor authentication. They can just keep logging in. Because at the point which that user gets enforced, which is the third step, they won't be able to use just their username and their account password. That will not be an acceptable form for login for any kind of application. So the user will have to have done something about it. And we're not going to switch the user from enabled to enforced until they have configured their second factor of authentication. All right, so we figure if the user has configured their second factor of authentication, they'll have learnt about multi-factor authentication, they know they have to use an app password for their rich client apps, and so they're going to know what to do. If they haven't configured it, maybe they don't, and so we let them continue to log in with their account password. Hope that makes sense. So I'm going to go and log in as Bonnie K. Got that wrong. Okay, so here's Bonnie K's password. And when I sign in, got it wrong. Where's my peer programming? Don't you guys do peer programming in talks? So I spelt this wrong again. Okay, is that right? No one? No. All right, what's happening now? So I've actually logged in. I got my username and password eventually correct. And it says your admin has required that you set this account up for additional security verification. Set it up now or sign out. Okay, so I have no option other than to configure my second factor of authentication. And here's where I do that. It says, what's your preferred option? We'll use this option by default. Call my mobile phone. And actually, I don't want it to call my mobile phone because I'm international roaming, so I'm going to do this sort of weird thing here where I'm going to say my mobile phone number is that number there so that it can call me. So it says, hey, you've configured your second factor of authentication. We want to verify that before you have to log in with it. Why is this important? If I got the phone number wrong, I can't log in after I've saved this. So it's going to verify that before it saves it. All right, it's trying to call me on what I said was my mobile number, which is actually my office number, which rings on my phone, on my PC. Okay, so we'll answer the call.
Thank you for using Microsoft Verification System. Press the pound key to finish verifying your account.
Okay.
Your account has been verified. Goodbye.
So that's it. So now, anytime that Bonnie K logs in, she's got to take a phone call and press the pound key. So let's save these updates. Let's do that, and then I'll show you how you can set up the mobile app, which I've got my trusty mobile device over here. Your updates were successful, and it's noting that I'll need to create an app password. We might do that as well if we have time. All right, so it's making me sign in. It's making me sign in again because I've just configured that. So it's going to call me.
Thank you for using Microsoft Sign In Verification System.
You don't have to listen to her. All right, so now I'm signed in. I'm like, hey, I want to change my second factor of authentication, or maybe I want to go in and create an app password. So to do that, I've got to go into a standard place where you change your password, which is in this like Office 365 settings, and we'll choose password, change your password. And here, because I'm enabled for multi-factor authentication, it's got this extra piece of text and this link here. So I'll click on this link to change the phone numbers for multi-factor authentication. And here's the same dialog that we saw before, but it's got a few extra details. So it's got this app passwords tab here, and you're not shown this when you first proof up your second factor, because we want to make sure that you've actually signed in with your second factor before we let you create app passwords. And here I can change this to notify me through the app. So let's set up the app first. We'll go ahead and configure the app. So I'm going to try this. So I've got this barcode here. I sort of need a camera behind me. I guess that would cost a bit more money. So I want to show you what this looks like on the screen. Not quite sure how to do that. Let's get this set up and then we'll show you what it looks like afterwards. So I'm going to grab this. Here it is. And we'll switch over to 3. And you can see my app here. This is the multi-factor auth app. And it's finished configuring because it's got that number come up. So let's switch back. And it says, if the app displays a 6-digit number, you're all done. So we'll click done. And then it's checking the activation status on my phone. It's going to be okay. Yep. So I'll save. And now remember, because I've changed my second factor, it's got to verify me. So I'm going to switch over so we can watch that. Please respond to the notification on the device is what I see on the screen. So here it is. The app has come up and said verify or cancel. If you didn't log in with your password and this pops up on your phone at some point, cancel enables you to go ahead and report that someone is trying to hack into your account. Okay, so my updates are successful and I've logged in there. So now if I log out and I come back in and log in, it's going to go ahead and just send a pop-up to my app that I've installed here. This app, by the way, is just a phone app, and it takes push notifications like any other app would. If you don't want to use push notifications, you can use that 6-digit number that we saw on the screen, and you can enter that. So there's a variety of different ways that you can use that. Let's just go back in here one more time and take a look at that app passwords. So app passwords, if you remember, is required for a rich client application, and I'm signed in with two-factor auth here, so I can go in as a user and create these app passwords, and maybe I want one for my link client. So this name, it's just a tag that helps me to remember what I want to use it for, and it's given me this password here, so I can copy that to the clipboard. It says that will not be displayed again, and then I could go into one of my apps, so maybe in link, and I could sign out here. No, that's not what I want to do. File, sign out. And then we'll say bonniek@pool20.microsoft.com. And we'll sign in. I presume it will actually prompt me for a password. I hope it does. I'm ready with a password. Doesn't look good. Link doesn't really like signing in as multiple people at the same time, or even signing out and signing back in. It's got this connection to Outlook that's going on, and doesn't look like it's going to do it. Oh, it just says no. No. So a dialog should come up and say, hey, what's your password? And I can paste in that long 16-character one, and I should be able to sign in. It's not going to happen there, so I'm going to skip it. All right. So that was multi-factor authentication. Real quick, I bet there were. Yes. Question.
So do they have to go through that process every single logon, or is it just a once per device type process?
So yes, the current feature is every logon for users who are enabled for multi-factor auth, they'll have to do their second factor of authentication. Yep. Any other questions about multi-factor auth? Yep.
Once I've got a session, can I log into other applications without having to do that?
Yes. So it's currently tied to the Windows Azure Active Directory login, which is through a cookie in your browser. If you have a session, as long as the timeout for that session that's configured by your organization is still going, you can keep that session going and not have to enter that second factor again.
If I'm logged on premise and go into 365, if 365 is set for 2FA, do I still have to do the 2FA login, or will it recognize the session I've got on premise?
That's a good question. This is going to be an example where you're using Active Directory Federation services, and you're logged on-premise, and ADFS would typically log you directly on without requiring a second factor. I'm not sure. That's a good question. I'll have to check on that. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. Right. So if a user doesn't have their second factor with them, there's a couple of stages they can go through. In the calling your phone or the checking your second factor screen that comes up, you have the option of selecting an alternate second factor. And so you can have a mobile phone, a desk phone, an app, and you can configure to use any one of those. You can't configure that while you're logging in for obvious reasons, but if you configure those in advance, you can use one of those. If you don't have any of them, or you've only created one and you've lost it, you're going to have to ask your administrator to reset your account so that you can create another one. And the administrator can either disable second factor auth or erase the second factor and have you start again. Yeah.
Sorry, is there going to be a usage fee for all the phone calls?
we actually have not announced licensing at this time. The phone calls do cost some money. Yep.
Good question. Do you have any authentication option against one of the user ID attributes, for example, the brand name?
I'm sorry, I missed the fourth word. Do you have any?
Like any authentication method towards an ID attribute, for example, the brand name or something? So let's pretend that the user doesn't have the username or password. They only know the username and you log in against one of the ID attributes, like the brand name or the title name.
No, the user is going to have the password. Yep. Another one? Does it work with ActiveSync? So multi-factor auth relies on the client. ActiveSync implies an app on a mobile phone. Apps would have to be updated in order to work with multi-factor auth. However, app passwords will work with ActiveSync, just like they work with rich clients. Make sense? Yep. Any other multi-factor auth questions at the back?
You mentioned that if you use ADFS, it will comply with the password policy. So when you change your password, you're using Azure, how do you make sure that it complies with your services policy?
We're talking about Active Directory Federation services. When you change your password where? What did you say?
When you log into your Office 365.
Yes. Yes.
So how do you
So the question is, how do you make sure that your password that you enter in Office 365 complies with your on-premises password policy? And there's three ways that this can happen. If you're using a cloud identity, it does not. It has a password policy that you've set in Office 365, which is very limited. The second way is directory synchronization. If you're using directory synchronization, you can only change passwords on-premises, so they will comply with your on-premises password policy. The third is ADFS. If you're using ADFS, you can change your password on-premises or in the cloud. However, changing password in the cloud is actually using a web page as part of the ADFS servers, which is changing your password on-premise so that it uses the on-premise password policy. All right. So let's move on. I think we're about right on time. So I have a couple of other things that have come out pretty recently. The Graph API allows you to write PowerShell that can work with Windows Azure Active Directory. And this is used if you have an identity provider that is not Active Directory, so it won't support DirSync tool. So if you can't use the DirSync tool, how do you synchronize identities into the cloud? Typically the way that you would do that is write PowerShell and use the Graph API that we've provided to get identities created up in the cloud. So this is a REST API for manipulating the cloud identity provider. Azure Active Directory connector for FIM. FIM is very popular with larger identity installations. It's another product that you can that Microsoft sells. We've recently added a Azure Active Directory connector that you can use with that, so that FIM can be used with Office 365. There's a number of other connectors that you can use with FIM, but we're covered for Office 365 there. All right, so the third part of this talk, and it looks like I have roughly 25 minutes left for this, is the identity integration options. So we already talked about three options for identity integration. Can you all remember what they were? What was the first one? Cloud identities. The second one? Synchronized. And the third? Federated. Right. And remember I said that that was a little simplistic, and actually it's quite a lot more complicated than that. So I want to show you a more complicated view. But when you're having conversations with business people, typically you will just get to the level of cloud identities, synchronized and federated. So here we go. The first one, again, is just cloud identities. There is not much in addition that you can do with cloud identities to split it out and make it more complicated. It's really not configurable. It's what you get in the Office 365 small business SKUs, or the P SKUs, because they do not have any Active Directory synchronization. It means you're creating and using users online only. It has no hardware requirements, which is great. And the source of authority, interesting term there, source of authority. So where is the data homed? This is in the cloud. So the second one here, directory sync. And I actually have a slide on each of these, so I won't talk too much through them here. Directory sync is what we had before June this year, where we didn't have this password hash sync. So a lot of people are familiar with the DirSync tool, and they're familiar with its big limitation that you can't have the same password in the cloud and on-premise. So directory sync is the second column there. The third one, password sync. Well, it's exactly the same as directory sync, except for we also synchronize the password hash into the cloud. Fourth one is our Graph API, and I started to talk about this already. This is where you're using PowerShell or some other scripting language with our REST APIs in order to manipulate the cloud directory. You're both going to add things, remove things, and change things that are in the cloud directory based on something that's going on premises. And this is, again, typically used with third-party or non-Microsoft identity providers, which we support, by the way. The Forefront Identity Manager is there. So Forefront Identity Manager is Microsoft's identity management suite. So that's number five. Number six is single sign-on and is often referring to Active Directory Federation services, but also can refer to other products, which we also support Office 365 when connected with. All right, so let's dive into a little more detail on each of these. First up, we talked about cloud identity. We talked about this a couple of times, so I won't spend any time on this again. It is the simplest form. Again, I just mentioned this is your only option if you have one of the Office 365 small business SKUs. So if you have customers who've purchased Office 365 through Telstra, they will often use the P SKUs that we make available through Telstra. These SKUs have a limit of 25 users, so these are going to be pretty small organizations that are getting into this. And they don't have any of the Active Directory integration options, so they only have this possibility. Directory synchronization, so the DirSync tool, once you step up from the P SKU, which, by the way, we've announced the ability coming later this year for users to switch plans from P SKU to M SKU, or the medium business and the enterprise business SKUs. So customers will be able to upgrade from the P SKU and make use of Active Directory synchronization, which is awesome. So that's planned for later this calendar year, but we've announced that. So here we go. We've got a DuraSync tool connecting to Active Directory. You just need one server. Now, this is depending on how many objects you have in your directory. If you've got a small number of objects, you can just use one server in SQL Express. We have a limit. I think it's around 100,000. Could be wrong there. But we have some TechNet docs about what size of hardware, RAM, and separating your SQL Server onto a different box that you require depending on the number of objects that you're synchronizing. Synchronizing does take time, so that's one of the reasons why the hardware needs to be increased for larger directories. And so this is typically taking your on-premise directory and synchronizing it into an OU in the cloud, and then your users can log in the cloud with the same password there. Same username. Password sync. That gives you the same password. Here it is. Otherwise, exactly the same. Just an extra checkbox. There is quite a lot of changes, actually, to the DuraSync tool to enable password synchronization. We've got those that extra hash being synchronized. We're running every 2 minutes as well as every 10 minutes to check for passwords that are changed. There's a few new messages that might appear in the event logs. So it is just a checkbox in there. It's simple to set up, but there is a little bit behind that. So scoping and filtering for synchronization, there are a few things that you can do to filter out the filter different objects out, particularly selecting an OU for synchronization purposes, which you can configure with PowerShell connecting to the directory. We don't support currently filtering out different properties from your directory. And so we need all of the properties, whether they be custom properties or default properties, that each user object has to be synchronized up to the cloud. Largely the reason for that is there's a lot of different services behind Office 365 that make use of the directory. We don't want any of those to fail for no good reason. So at the moment, the supported installation is we need all of those properties to be synchronized up to the cloud. Multi-forest directories. How do you synchronize a directory that has multiple forests? Well, it's a little more difficult. The DuraSync tool that you get from the Office 365 users and groups only supports a single forest. So in order to get multi-forest, there's a couple of things you've got to look at. I have a little flow chart here to think about how you do that. If you only have, and I'll just walk through this flowchart from the top. If you only have one forest, you're good to go. You can head out to the right here and use the single forest DuraSync, which is available directly to download. If you have multiple forests, then you've got to go down into the next box, and I'm going to ask you, hey, if you have multiple forests, do you want to consolidate them? It's likely the answer is no. Otherwise, you possibly would have done that already. A lot of large organizations have very complicated directories. But if you do want to consolidate, we have a nice white paper on TechNet that will walk you through consolidating different account forests or resource forests. If you don't want to consolidate, then we've got to look at how many exchange orgs that you have. And if you have multiple exchange orgs, and this essentially means you've got exchange servers in separate parts of your directory, then we can't do that. We can't synchronize that with Office 365 and the Microsoft tools. So you need to have some consolidation going on. If you have a single Exchange org or one Exchange org, then we can go ahead and use this thing called the multi-forest DuraSync. And this is a little more complicated to set up, and it's only available for use with Microsoft Consulting Services gigs. So there you go. That's how you can set up. You can get started with multi-forest synchronization. All right, we talked about PowerShell Graph REST API a little bit. Requires some scripting experience. And we talked about the Office 365 connector for Forefront Identity Manager. This is something that's available for use right now and can allow you to configure more complicated directory synchronization scenarios with Forefront Identity Manager and connect them into Windows Azure Active Directory. Federated identity is where we look at, of course, doing either single sign-on or just, hey, you want your authentications to be done on-premise. And this may be with Active Directory Federation services, or it may be with a third-party STS or identity provider, or it may be with Shibboleth, which is a SAML-based identity provider. Shibboleth is something that we support out of the box with Office 365. We have TechNet documentation on configuring that. The Shibboleth identity provider is used by a number of educational organizations, and it's available as open source for connecting it up. One thing about Shibboleth is it does not support the Office-rich clients apart from Outlook. So if you're using Shibboleth or you've got a customer that wants to use Shibboleth, it's important to have that conversation up front about this is going to restrict to the web-based clients to Office 365 plus Outlook. Outlook is able to use an extension for Shibboleth, which is called ECP. Sometimes Shibboleth installations don't have this extension, so you just need to add that, or your customer would need to add that in order to get Outlook to work. We find a lot of people are happy just to use the web interfaces and Outlook. Specifically, what this means you can't use from Office 365, you can't use Word or Excel to download docs from SharePoint Online. You can't use the SkyDrive Pro Sync tool that runs in the tray. You can't have Office 365 Pro Plus licensing, which is the Office client applications licensed from Office 365. All of those things require the WS Trust authentication, which Shibboleth doesn't provide. So Shibboleth is an option there for Federation. Also, third-party STSs are an option for Federation. And we have a program called Works with Office 365 Identity, where Microsoft has engaged with certain identity providers and done testing with those identity providers connected to Office 365, such that Microsoft can qualify those identity providers and be able to support customers, Microsoft customers who are using Office 365 when they are working with those identity providers. So flexibility, use the identity provider that you want, confidence is qualified by Microsoft, and coordinated support. So if you call Microsoft and you have a problem with Office 365, we're able to determine that it's actually a problem with the identity provider, we can put you on to the third party for support. Microsoft supports the issues with Office 365, the identity provider company would support their product. But the two work together through this program. So these are the companies that are currently in the works with Office 365 identity program. And there's a URL with a public web page that can give you some more information about those. You can see I've got three boxes here showing the level or the protocols that each of these support. WS Federation or SAMLP are the protocols which are used to support our web-based clients. And SAMLP can also have that ECP extension to support Outlook. So you should consider that. WS Trust is the protocol required to support the Office-rich clients that I talked about. So WS Trust and WS Federation together gives you the full support that you would have with Active Directory and ADFS. All right, just a couple of other things here to talk about. Client access control is giving you the ability to limit various locations or IP addresses or times of day that can connect into Office 365. So some additional configurability that you get there with Active Directory Federation services. And then here's a look at Windows Azure Active Directory working with other cloud services. So once you've got your directory in Windows Azure Active Directory, it's possible to use that for other cloud services and use Windows Azure Active Directory as your identity provider. So this is something that we're seeing more and more interest in. We know there's a lot of customers who are using Office 365 very heavily and have populated these directories, and so providing access to the Windows Azure Active Directory is the next logical step for that product. All right. So I have a few minutes left, I wanted to just give a quick summary of what we've talked about today. Now, this talk was intended as an overview, and what I really wanted to get across is the difference between a cloud-based identity, a synchronized identity, and a federated identity. And then I showed you a few examples of new features that we have in this space. We looked at password sync with its two-minute timeout, and we looked at multi-factor authentication in a little bit of depth. And so these are the six different ways that you can use identities with Office 365. Number one is good for the small business SKU, the P SKU. Two through six are good for our medium bit SKUs and enterprise SKUs. And we've got a couple of directory sync options. Graph API and PowerShell are an option that you have. You can write PowerShell to modify the directory, and they're required if you're using a non-AD based directory that can't support the DirSync tool, because synchronization is required before authentication. And then Forefront Identity Manager and Federation being your different options for, or Federation at least being your option for authentication where you don't want to do that in the cloud. We talked about ADFS, we talked about Shibboleth based on SAML, and then we talked about the Works with Office 365 Identity Program. All right. So if there's any more questions, I'd love to hear those. I'm sure you're also aware that you can win a mouse by completing an evaluation. So love to hear about that as well. Oh, and it's gonna play some more slides. Are there any other questions about identity before we sign off? Yeah. It doesn't have to be the same, but we are going to use the UPN from on-premise in the cloud, and we do require that. We actually synchronize the identities based on a GUID that's derived from the UPN that's in the directory. You can't have multiple domains on your UPNs, so it is a very critical component, but it doesn't have to be exactly the same as the email address. Yep. Yes, it's a new thing, and yes, I believe it's relatively difficult to set up. So I see a few people leaving, so I just wanted to thank you all for coming along. Please do do an eval. Also, I would love to hear from you about your identity implementations. My Twitter handle is PNDRW, and my email address is pandrew@microsoft.com. I work on Office 365 identity pretty much all the time, so I'd love to hear about complex or interesting things that you're doing. So I just want to thank you for coming along, and I think we can take more questions for another 10 minutes or so. So at the back in the blue. I'm sorry, I can't quite hear you.
Rename flow through.
Rename.
Or is there something special you need to do if you rename the UPN on premises? That was supposed to be.
Right. Yeah, we're going to have some trouble with UPN rename. I would have to follow up. If you want to send me an email, I can check into that. But UPN is something that we do have some trouble when you rename. Here. No, you should not federate with two different domains that have the same SID. What may work is if the accounts have the same unique ID, then you can use this as a transition mechanism from one domain to another, but you should not synchronize with two domains. That's not supported.
So we don't, but two organizations, at least one organization.
Yes. It's not a supported scenario. You need to have a single identity provider. Are you saying that's working for you? Yes, we would not want to support that. However, you can mitigate that by getting back to a single identity provider. Lots of organizations will have multi-organization identity providers that they use, regardless of the separation. But if you have separate directories which are growing independently, it's not going to be a...
Separate legal entities now, different companies that are
right.
One company, have no relationship.
In Canada, there is an organization that manages identity for all of the colleges across the country. They're all separate organizations. They have contracts with this group that runs identity provisioning for all the colleges. Maybe something like that would work. What we are not able to do is have two directories synchronizing with a single Office 365 tenant or a Windows Azure Active Directory OU, or for that matter have one directory synchronizing with two Office 365 tenants. We can't do that either because the identities are actually the same when they get up into the cloud. So we don't support either of those. You need to have a single identity provider on-premise that Windows Azure Active Directory can connect to. There's a hand behind you.
The AWS main space sort of blocking of IPs and access externally.
Yeah.
So it's listed as saying you can block access to the O365. But what if you just want to run Outlook anyway, but not let them sign into the actual service? And through the browser and all that sort of thing.
You want to allow them to run Outlook Web Access?
Outlook anywhere. So if you call that client on your laptop.
Uh-huh. I'm gonna have to check on that for you. We don't differentiate between the client connecting and the browser connecting right now, so I'm not sure how we would do that. Yep.
So you said that there's scope for getting third-party cloud applications to get their identity direct from Windows Azure Active Directory.
Yep.
What about bringing that down to the actual replacing a complete on-premise AD in the future? Would that be having the primary source in the cloud or the on-premise? Is that something which you think will happen?
We don't have a plan for doing that right now. That's an interesting idea. I'm not sure that would be... I don't know what customers would think of doing something like that. You can do that today if you really want to. You can spin up a Windows Azure virtual machine, get a VPN connected from it through to your on-premise systems and run a DC in the cloud. You can actually run your ADFS servers in Windows Azure VMs that way. And so effectively, that's going to give you an Active Directory in the cloud. It's not Windows Azure Active Directory as your Active Directory, but that's a way that you could do that. Hey, we'll take one more question, and my time is up for this afternoon.
Are there any gotchas with doing dirsync to ADLDS instead of your main domain controllers?
We're gonna be able to do that if you want to do that. You can do dirsync to Atom if you want to install that. Dirsync just needs to see a domain controller-like entity that it can connect to. There are a couple of third parties that are able to pretend to be dirsync, pretend to be AD, and dirsync will connect to them just fine. I'm not sure if that's supported, because we say we need to connect to a domain controller, but there certainly are other products that you can use and a variety of implementations. All right, I'm out of time. I'm going to be down in the showcase. I'd love to catch up with more people and talk about identity, but I've got to get off the stage.
Now? Are you going down now?